Stringer and the Hanging Judge by Luke Cameron. Narrated by Peter Berkrot. Chapter 1. A dank summer fog with seaweed on its breath had crept in through the Golden Gate while most of the town was asleep. So the city room at the San Francisco Sun was ablaze with Edison bulbs, despite the 9 a.m. hour when Stringer showed up. His crusty features editor, old Sam Barca, didn't do or say one thing to dispel the gloom when Stringer joined him in the sort of frosted glass cage they kept old Sam in, lest he jar the ears and fillings of the women, and some men, the Sun had hired since the Spanish-American War, in the name of progress. Barca was a newspaper man of the old school, who only worried about pungent observations when they were spelled or punctuated wrong. Stringer could tell old Sam was fixing to cloud up and rain all over somebody. So he grabbed a bentwood chair, took a seat, and commenced to roll a smoke as he hoped it wasn't him. It was. Old Sam began by calling Stringer a bull-headed, bastardly idiot with an obvious longing for unemployment, and then he said, louder, "If I told you once, I've told you a million or more times to stay the hell away from Fort Mason, MacKail. What do you mean by turning in another two columns about our brave boys embarking two by two to civilize the Filipinos with their buttstocks and bayonets?" Stringer licked his Bull Durham, sealed it tightly, and lit the resultant smoke. Then he shrugged. "Nobody has told me that our occupation of the Philippines was some kind of state secret," he replied. "Teddy Roosevelt in the flesh was up at Fort Mason to send them on their way with inspirational speeches, plural. He can't stop after one speech once he gets wound up. I feel sure more than one trooper felt mighty anxious to get aboard and below decks long before old T.R. got to reading them that cablegram from Rudyard Kipling, loud enough to rattle windows all along North Beach." Sam Barca grimaced, which didn't make his leathery brown face look sweeter. "You had no call to poke fun at Rudyard Kipling either," he snapped. "It's sort of refreshing to find a son of a bitching limey who actually seems to approve of our manifest destiny in the Pacific, damn it." Stringer blew a smoke ring and raised an eyebrow as he peeked through it at old Sam. "I never made fun of the asshole," he muttered. "I just ran his congratulations to us as he wrote it, in verse, for Pete's sake." Barker looked uncertain. "Do you mean it was him and not you who referred to the Filipino rebels as half-savage and half-child?" But when Stringer nodded, Sam still insisted. "Forget it. You're bucking the tide of public opinion again. How many times do I have to tell you that you'd be as big a journalist as Richard Harding Davis or your pal Jack London if only you'd slant your news items the way our readers want to read them?"
"Slanted news isn't news, Sam," Stringer answered flatly. "If I hadn't wanted to be an accurate reporter, I'd have never put myself through all those journalism courses at Stanford by herding cows on the side. I have to call things as I see them. It's enough trouble writing fancier than I was ever taught to talk when what I'm putting down on paper is true. If you don't want to run my feature on those latest troop movements..."
"I want to, but I can't," Barca cut in, adding with a sigh. "I guess I was about your age when I covered Little Bighorn, as it looked to me at the time. They blue-penciled my accurate observation regarding the advantages of sending troopers armed with single-shot saddle carbines against Indians armed with repeaters, when the government knew its own Indian agency had issued the same to the Lakota Confederacy."
"I fear Custer was a mite before my time," Stringer said. "But if what you say is true, I'm sure I'd have written her that way as well."
Barca nodded.
"I know. That's why I'm an editor today while you are a semi-employed Stringer who's fortunate as hell I think he has the makings of a newspaper man in him, when and if he ever wises up. Our readers don't want to know our boys get to fight so good with their bayonets because the Krag is a lousy rifle. There's no point informing them that the notion of our picking up the white man's burden sounds dumb as soon as you ask..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.